Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Alok Madhukar, and I'm joined by my colleagues, Subramaniam Ramamoorthi and Rishabh Maheshwari, and we are from Goldman Sachs, Bangalore. So today we are going to present how we are using FoundationDB in financial services. So there is a mandatory disclaimer. Okay, so we have been using a system called SecDB. It stands for Securities Database, and it was built in 1991, so it's been 28 years. And there are some numbers here which kind of signify the scale of the operations that we have. So the system has been running stable for over 28 years now. And at this point, we wanted to kind of evaluate how we modernize the plant. So to give some background, like why we built a system like SecDB, and what were the, some of the design decisions made. So what we wanted from a data platform was that our trading is happening in all the countries, roughly 160 different locations. So we want to capture the risk artifacts across all these locations. So the throughput needs to be very high. So these businesses can be equities or foreign exchange. So these are very kind of high throughput environment. So we need to kind of roughly, let's say, capture 3 billion trades happening in a given location. And then we want to have real-time risk, which means that if a trader books some trades in Tokyo and a trader in New York is working on the same account, he should be able to have real-time risk on the system. And then we are kind of regulated, a highly regulated environment, so we need quick reproducibility of results, which means that we may be asked to go back in 10 years and explain why a certain price was arrived. And then we are in a scenario where we actively need to kind of do what-if analysis. What if some governments go down? What if market conditions change? So we run through billions of these different shocks to see what will be the risk through this, what will be the pricing in these different risk scenarios. Finally, we want identical pricing across all our offices, like front office, middle office, back office, and irrespective of location, and minimum time to market. So there are two pieces to the magic that is happening here. One is the client side. So the client side enables us to have good what-if analysis, where, let's say, we developed our own development environment, which enables to have a graph-like environment. So if I have a formula C equals A plus B, it will automatically make a directed acyclic graph, and the calculations can happen. It enables memoization, so many of the results can be reused. And the time to market is enabled by our SDLC, where few click buttons and your system or your code is in production. So the for the rest of the topic, we'll be focusing on the other piece, which is the persistence layer, and what we have done there, and what is the evolution there. So this is, we came up with a very simple backend design, which is a in-memory blob store, essentially, right? So there is a shared memory. It has parallel readers and serialized writes. So there are components to writes, which is checker, logger, and applier. These can be pipelined to kind of increase some of the throughput. But essentially, the blob store understands two kinds of objects. One, which is a blob, which is has a metadata, which has some essential information about the object, which is what class it is, and what are the essentially what is the type and what is the name. So the all the objects are stored, have indexes on name and type, and there is a variable size binary. Apart from that, there is a special object that the server understands, which is called a position. So that's a specific name for enabling our trade model. But a position is essentially a conflict-free data type, right? So it is implemented as an incremental. And in the next slide, I'll kind of focus more on what is a trade model, right? So now, one of the key features of our persistence is that, like, because of the simplicity, like, there are, like, five people as in the SRE team who manage a deployment of more than 10,000 physical kind of instances of this system. Now, we need to enable real-time risk at all locations. We need real-time synchronization of data. And it's a multi-master write environment where traders in any of the locations can be updating the objects. Now, we try to kind of design a system which reduces conflict. So it's an eventually consistent system. However, our trade model is designed in such a way that there are minimal conflicts. So to enable that, we have, for each of the physical instances, the trade ID range is unique. So the trade IDs don't overlap in different locations. The traders are trading in objects that are called tradables. So these tradables are either singletons or fungibles. So when I say singletons, for example, a house in San Diego will be a singleton. So there is only kind of a specific type of house in San Diego. Something like oil will be fungible, which adds up. Like oil from Saudi Arabia or from Canada, they kind of add up, right? So you can trade these in either quantities of one or these things add up. So trades or transactions which are happening create positions on an account which are unique, and these positions, as I said, are incremental on the back end. So even though the traders might be acting on the same account, which are kind of, the conflicts don't happen in general. If conflicts do happen, we have a conflict resolution tool that kind of solves the conflicts. So to give some, again, there are few impressive numbers on the first slide, but now this is supporting the in-memory database or kind of NoSQL was kind of ahead of its time. But the key competitive advantage for us was that this was uniformly adopted across the entire firm. What that means is across 100 different business units, this is the single entry point for all the trades and all the risk. So through kind of why this is a competitive edge, because for example, when financial crisis happened, and I was on the trading floor, it was a single query for me to figure out what is our exposure to different counterparties. And this was very kind of very powerful. Secondly, we use the same persistence to distribute our code as well, right? So everyone has the same view of the world at all points of time. So what is USD versus Euro is the same price that anyone is seeing. Like nobody's checking out code and kind of doing pricing separately. So these are kind of very powerful features here. Now, what is in the future? So basically, as I mentioned, financial crisis, post that, that was an important year because post that, the nature of the industry itself changed. And so for example, a lot of derivative or proprietary trading became obsolete, and there were more algorithmic trading. So over time, there were more kind of engineers than traders and bankers, so we are at a point where we have more engineers. And secondly, the technology itself matured also, so where we were using our own language, which had both functional features and imperative features, now we have modern languages which support both. As well as on the persistent side, we have mature NoSQL offering. So apart from the businesses themselves are becoming more and more data driven, right? So many of the models that we rely on can be derived from data. So we want to build this platform for future, although this is still kind of very profitable for us. We want to redesign the system for future, and there are a few important considerations that we have. And these decisions are more directional than technical, which is we can again rewrite a proprietary system. We have good C++ developers who can do that. But as we look at the modern generation, they are more enthused by open source platforms and like having those skills which can be reused. So that's a very important decision for us, that a boutique solution that we have built, which is highly optimized for us. A single kind of system supports all kinds of use cases, be it high throughput trading, be it archives, be it ticking data. It solves everything. To go to a open source solution, which is more generic in nature, it's a very big engineering challenge for us to kind of match the requirements. So A, we want to use open source, and B, we don't want to make the observed performance of existing system any worse. So when we kind of, so in phase one, we don't want to change any of the clients, but as we change the backend, we don't want clients to face any kind of performance degradation, and that's where all the engineering challenge comes up. So how we are doing that? For that, I'll invite Rishabh Maheshwari. Like, what's our bean journey so far? So essentially, we are trying to solve two problems here. So one is, we want to replace our key value store. That will make the system as is compliant to our existing system. And secondly, because a blob store is not amenable to like server-side queries, the clients need to serialize the data on their side and then make queries. We want to also solve the OLAP problem here. So we have, apart from solving the OLTP solution, we have a real-time sync to make the blobs into attributes, and then move the query load to this attribute store, right? So that's how we are kind of thinking about the new system, and Rishabh will take you through the journey, how we are going there.
Thank you, Alok. Hi, everyone. Okay, so let me take you through the journey of how we started with FoundationDB and what are the steps we took and where we are right now. So as Alok told, that we already have a proprietary system with us, which is basically we have clients, we have the backend, which is essentially a blob store, and we have a well-defined protocol. And the first thing which we wanted was that we wanted an as-is replacement of the backend without any change in clients, which means that what we started with is that as-is replacement of the blob store, which means that we first defined a middleware. So we first defined a unit which is between the FoundationDB blob store and the clients, and we supported the same protocol as is, which is currently in SecDB. So the first step was that a middleware which has discoverable endpoints with the same protocol as is. And also the first offering which we gave was that basic CRUD operations, which will insert the blob and retrieve the blob for the client. Apart from that, the second point is that in SecDB, rather, apart from being a simple document store, it also has some limited indexing support. So when I say limited indexing support, if you're familiar with record layer or document layer indexing, it's very similar to it, which means that a client, so schema here is managed on the client side, which means that when a client wants to store a document, it will serialize the document as a blob store and store it in the FoundationDB. And if a client wants to fetch the document, it will get the blob, deserialize it from the client's client-side managed schema and get it. The indexing support is something like we can register what attributes of an object or a security are indexed. And what happens is that client knows that these attributes are indexed, so the client sends the blob with the indexed values registered in a particular format. And if other clients want to query those indexes, they can basically start with an offset and iterate through the indexes. It's very similar to how record layer and document layer do it. Other than that, with the as-is replacement, so these are the as-is replacement for the client, for the users. For our DevOps team, our current system already has tools like backup, restore, and other systems and other tools. We tried to replace all these features as is for them as well. So these are some of the features which FoundationDB supports out of the box. So they were all supported as is. Other than that, one of the things which Alok mentioned was that apart from the simple limited support which we have, that is blob store and indexing, our clients also wanted the support of rich server-side queries, which means that if we index something, or we provide attributes to the server, We should have ability to support rich server-side queries like aggregation or composite indexes, et cetera. And that's where we founded record layer very helpful, and that's where we are using it. So what we did was we encode the attributes in protobuf format, store it, and based on using record layer or record layer principles, we tried to have these queries. And also, the other thing is that next we looked at the other requirements of clients. For example, one of the main requirements of clients is that they want to measure risk as of a particular milestone. So what was the risk if this condition was valid, or what was the risk as of some particular time? And we wanted some milestone based on which we can query data, and the roadmap of FoundationDB looks exactly to what our future roadmap is, which is there's a roadmap for Redwood Engine, which will provide that milestoning layer. So that is what it is. So this is a journey where we try to do as-is replacement of FoundationDB with our system, and this is where it fits our bill, FoundationDB exactly as-is. But there are a lot of places where it doesn't fit the bill, and for that I will invite Subbu.
Hi, hello everyone. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the next steps, which means we are not in production yet. So we have done a lot of analysis, and this is more about the what we need to do before we actually go to production. So being a financial firm, I mean, the need or the kind of the DevOps requirement on the security requirements are pretty high for us. And also the environment what we operate is a little bit different. So because we actually have our thick clients who directly interact with the native blob store, which means we don't really, there isn't like a strict need for a layer in the middle for the read operations. So we have these hundreds of thousands of clients running on one side, and you have a server on the other side, which we think will be FoundationDB, and they want to natively read the data and do something on that side. So that brings in a lot of interesting propositions. Like, what about a DDoS? When we natively expose this cluster to these hundreds of thousands of clients, can all of them hit the cluster at one go and bring down the cluster, and can they overwhelm the infrastructure? So how do we manage something like that? And then comes some of the regulatory and the audit kind of requirements. Like for us, we have to record every single meaningful thing that happens in a production system, which means if somebody is like adding a machine to a cluster or taking a machine out of the cluster, we actually have to record everything. So how do we do that? And then we have things like purely the security, the authentication. So who made a transaction? How do we identify what a client is? So while FoundationDB as this asset blob store ticked all the boxes, and then we realized we can't really expose it. We can't really run FoundationDB natively as a service for the clients directly. And that is where we are, and we need to build a layer to, like a DevOps layer to, and a security layer to secure a lot of these operations. And the next part is performance. So as I said, we have a thick clients, and sometimes even a desktop-based clients running on one side. That kind of means the concurrent connection requirement is like 100,000 requirement. So it currently we kind of scale, but FoundationDB is not built for that. So we still think the layer will actually help us scale for that. And we have other things like the fast restore and backup. That is a very, very key requirement for us, because at the moment it is a complete in-memory system. In 10 minutes, we can actually have a clone of a database running. The size is small, but the bar is pretty high, because it's quite literally takes 10 minutes for us to, if we have a database running in New York and we want to have a copy of that running in London, it takes 10 minutes for us to copy the data over and start another instance. So that is another one. And it's kind of path ahead. As I said, we plan to write this DevOps layer, which we think is generic, will be useful for the rest of the community. And we want to build it, and we want to give it back to the community. That is one part, and also help with some of the capacity requirements. And in terms of the collaboration, as I said, we want to write this layer in a generic way so that, you know, it can be used by other people. So we'll like some reviews and feedbacks from you guys. And then the ASAF requirement is a very, very key and a very interesting requirement. It is sort of a game changer for what we have in the current system. So whenever the Redwood engine comes, we are really looking forward to it. We'll help you with testing and also adoption. Just quickly give to Alok for the closing remarks.
Yeah, so I think like SecDB has been kind of touted as the secret sauce of Wall Street. So this is the first year when we are talking about it in international conferences. So this is a very big kind of milestone from our side. And our collaboration with FoundationDB has been very good so far. So looking forward to the journey. Thank you.